So I know a lot of you enjoyed Tyler Hoechlin's performance as Superman, but as far as I'm concerned, bye Superman, go get your own show. And you know what? Maybe he will. Yes, adding Superman to the Supergirl first two episodes, and maybe some in the future, I think was a real catch-22. Because on the one hand, they wanted to get more guys watching the show, namely the CW audience that tried Supergirl over on CBS and then fled in droves, right? But they were able to get the guys into the show by giving them a guy to watch. And Supergirl, one of the nicest things about the Supergirl show is that it promotes women in really cool roles, right? And I know that when you hear that, you're like, ew, right? I'm sure even some women, if I heard that out of context, I'd be like, that's disgusting. But when you see it in the show, you're like, you're doing important work here, carry on. And I'm enjoying it, and I know a lot of you were as well. So I understand why they did it, but I'm really upset about it too. And I think Tyler Hoechlin, he's a better Clark Kent than a Superman, but a lot of people liked him as Superman. I saw headlines talking about how good he was as Superman. So many, in fact, that again, if I were a CW executive, I'd be like, why do I have a Supergirl show? Maybe I should have a Superman show. Either as a spinoff or let's just get rid of Supergirl. And while he's gone, now Kara has the tremendous task of keeping these viewers watching, and they're doing it by giving her some training wheels still, and that's more dudes. Snapper Carr, James Olsen in an expanded role, although if he's gonna run Catco, how's he gonna be Guardian? We'll see. And then also Win over at the DEO, Win Schott, he has a much more expanded role. You know, when he was talking really fast before and cracking a lot of jokes, I just chalked it up to him like nervously flirting with Kara, right? But he's not flirting with anyone at the DEO, and he's just becoming like that stereotypical geek. And I would think that Wynn would be capable of being a little bit more professional. I'd tell him about it, but then I'm afraid he'd go full toy man, and he is around a lot of goodies. So I guess we'll just let him continue to do it. I feel very bad that Cat Grant has left. She was such a strong female force on the show, and I think a beacon for Supergirl. And her influence will rear its head, as it did in this episode, and I will point it out later in this episode, in this review of the episode. But at least the women are still villains, right? I hope they're good villains. I have to say, I do miss Maxwell Lord quite a bit. Come back, Peter Facinelli. You can fly to Canada. I'm sure you've worked in Canada many times. You make so many B vehicles, like B movies and TV shows, and that's being generous. Also, I think with Superman, I'm hoping, you know, I think that his character being there split the focus of the show. And I think these first two episodes were very good with the terms of the visual effects and the new sets. You know, it's like, ooh. But I think if you were like to think for a moment about the actual episodes, they're not particularly well written, at least not in comparison to the first season. The first season of Supergirl was actually really strong in the writing, and it's the same writers. So that's what leads me to believe that it's their attention is divided between trying to get enough airtime for Supergirl and Superman. Because I loved how in the first season, so often the A and B storylines reflected each other and offered commentary on each other. And that's missing, I think, from these first two episodes. Then number two, top five things worth discussing in the episode, Perry White Light. I do not like, and of course I'm talking about Snapper Carr. You can see his photo, right over there. Yes. You know, I really don't like making Kara Clark Kent Light, right? She's got her own Perry White now. Although I do enjoy the Clark Kent Perry White conversations. He's like, oh, I didn't mean to imply that you missed me, sir. I was like, I do like that. But I don't understand why Kara can't work at the DEO. I see no reason for her to be a reporter. It doesn't fit with her personality. And I agree with Snapper Carr that she's probably not a very good reporter. I mean, I would be like, you're going a little single white female here, single white superhero Kara with the Superman. She's like, I want to move to the same city. I'm going to comb my hair like his. Look, Clark, I got your hair cut. Love me. And I'm like, whoa, Kara. This might be why you are single. But no, she turned down perfectly good, but they didn't have any good chemistry. But anyway, I did like that she pulled a Peter Parker, right? Saying like, oh, here's an article. And I liked, you know, Kat's influence on her, that she threatened to take it to another paper if he didn't want it. I was like, ah, you've learned something, Kara. But, you know, the thing is that she pulled a Peter Parker because Clark Kent has never conducted himself in that manner. When he does journalism, I think really well, he does it either for two reasons. One, He chases the story first as Clark, and then he has to become Superman because that's the only person who can right the wrongdoing that he's uncovered as a reporter, right? And then the other thing is that he uses Clark Kent to fight his enemies on two fronts, both the superhero and the journalistic fronts. And I've always thought that was really interesting about Clark Kent as Superman. But, you know, that's why he's a journalist. I feel here they're just like, well, we're for Superman. Come on, guys, please watch Supergirl. Please. All right, so that was my problem with the second thing. Third, Metallo. I wasn't sure if I liked Metallo at first. At first I was like, these graphics are okay. And that I can tell that is just like a snap-on chest, you know, that you've put on there. But when his hand went metal after Supergirl melted it off, I geeked out hard time. I was like, okay, it's Metallo. I buy it. And I kind of liked the idea of multiple Metallos. It made sense, right? Why build one when you can have an army? It was very effective against multiple super people. And even if you weren't going to fight them, why not have more than one? If Cadmus can afford it, they should splurge. But I did think it was funny that Supergirl, when they saw him again, they played along and called him Metallo. I'd be like, I'm not calling you that. Forget it. And I did like turning Cadmus into like this really anti-immigrant, like hardcore revolutionary group, right? Which, of course, sadly, all too echoes a lot of things that are happening in politics, not only in the United States, but across the globe, as people have a knee-jerk reaction to immigration and assume the worst. So I thought that was that's the kind of writing I like seeing on Supergirl. So I'm curious to see that explored going forward. How do they explain its government funding? To WikiLeaks. All right, we'll just pull all the metaphors in here. All right, all the headlines. Number four, I really liked the Krypton versus Mars conversation between Kal-El and John Jones. I thought it was great. It was so cool to have these two guys talking. More Martian Manhunter. That's another thing. Superman takes up valuable Martian Manhunter time. But I really liked being like, Krypton is no Mars, and like how it shaped the two guys, just like coming from different countries shapes individuals. And that the war-torn Mars situation, although things didn't end too well on Krypton, as you might recall. Nobody believed Jor-El. You would think the Kal-El would take a lesson from that. But, you know, he's very optimistic. He's like, I don't really feel connected to that, because as you might recall, I was a mere baby. But I'd be like, so read the history books of your planet. But I did like that. I thought it was so cool to have like these two aliens trading notes on their Earth experience. I was like, this is great. I could have watched like a lot more of that, to be honest with you. Also, I thought the Fortress of Solitude, like the DEO, awesome upgrade. Oh, so much money. I'm sure most of it is actually computers and green screen, but I buy it. It looks good. And then fifth, oh, welcome back, Alex. I missed her so much in the first episode. I love Alex Danvers. As I've said before, I want to see Alex Danvers go into the comics. I think she's such a great character, especially as, like, she's kind of like Supergirl's Jim Gordon, right? But really, really, I like her just so much. She's a little bit like Sasha Bordeaux, actually, before OMAC took Sasha Bordeaux over and she kind of became a whole different thing. But so I like Sasha Bordeaux quite a bit. I miss her. She was Batman's bodyguard for a while. If you've never read those comics, go read them. They're amazing. But anyway, I liked seeing her back in action. I think she was a little off her game. I mean, going after the mole with no backup whatsoever. I mean, way to throw a tantrum that only hurts yourself, Alex, right? But I loved when she slid under the table when she was running away. I was like, what a great action move. And that actress, I don't know if it was stunt double or if it was her, but it looked really convincing. And then I liked the return of her power suit. But I don't understand. The power suit might, you know, I don't know. It's like Edge of Tomorrow and their power suits, right? Like, I understand the idea of the power suit from a narrative fantasy perspective. But, you know, these two things are really well done. So I always try and apply real world rules to it as much as I can, because I think that's when it succeeds the most. And okay, I'll forgive that she can throw a car without like hurting her arms, right? I'm like, okay, I'll go along with that. I mean, sure, it's a magic suit. But how can Metallo punch her unchecked in the jaw and not shatter it, right? You know, like you would think, like, I'd be like, oh, if you're going to go there, I guess go there. It's just so bad. I mean, I was like, she has no protection on her jaw. How is that okay? It doesn't make any sense. It's like, the suit projects a weird bubble around her. Leave me alone. It's hard writing these things. That's how I feel the writers would defend that. So that's my thoughts on Supergirl episode 2. I'm having a good time, but I'm ready to get down to business with episode 3, but now that Superman's gone, and I hope that we do. So what did you like about the episode, and what didn't you like? I'm excited to continue the conversation down below, and you can check out some more episodes right now.